So for a lot of people who live in cities, they may not see any of the Keyline design system and the work of PA Yeomans as relevant to them. Keyline design is a water and soil management system, primarily for designing farms in a rural landscape. But Yeomans also came up with a concept for applying Keyline to the design of cities, and he wrote a book called The City Forest in 1971. Now, the book introduced some really fascinating concepts for water management in the urban environment. Although he didn't put any drawings in the book of his finished city concepts, I will take inspiration from his work here and also some artistic license and liberty to explain the overall concept with a number of my own ideas integrated in. So here goes. Now, similar to what we've looked at for Keyline design thus far, we start with a main ridge or spine, primary ridges or arms, and a primary valley. Our city design will take place within one primary land unit in this model, enclosed by the main and primary ridges. This valley will face the winter sun so the city can make the most benefit from passive solar gain and access to natural light for all. Just as any design site is ideally situated within a complete hydrologic unit, we will use this one as the template for our city. The entire design will be built around the flow of rainwater within the city, as well as the flow and treatment of wastewater. Like everything else we're talking about in this course, the design for the flow of water creates the foundational structures on which everything else is layered. The greatest flow of water in the city is that of rainwater, the pulse of rainwater during heavy storms. This is because there's so many hard and impermeable surfaces in the city. There's roads, building, pathways, and plazas that run off all of the water that falls on them. So we'll need a city infrastructure that manages all of that water in a harmonious way. Now we'll start where we start with a lot of our designs, and we will place a lake on the key point, right? The key point being that place here where we go from a steep to a gentle slope. And we're going to create a main access road that diverts water towards the lake all the way from these ridges. So putting a pond right here at the base of the slope and having an access road that feeds the pond means the road is going to come from the ridges and it's going to cross the contour lines, meaning that there's a drop on the road to shunt water from the road surface and anything else directed onto it, onto this key point pond. So I've put this road that is sloped from the ridge down towards the lake on both sides. And this will be the primary drainage pattern on which our city is built. So we're going to put in a succession of lakes in the valley and connect them to the ridges with the main feeder road. Each lake will have feeder roads from the ridges sloping to the valleys. All right, so now I've put in these roads here coming from the ridges and concentrating water in this series of lakes. And this is the main frame infrastructure now of the city. And we've really divided the city into three major areas at this point. Now we have this slope here up above this uppermost key point lake, and we're going to call this Uptown. Then we have the area encompassed by the lakes that we'll call Midtown, and then we have the area down below the lakes that we're going to call Lowtown. Now in P.A. Yeoman's initial design for the cities, he suggested that these actually be kept empty in order to be able to collect water for flood control. So that's just something to think about. So now we're going to arrange the uptown area here. Now the uptown, we're going to consider the center of governance, like center city, where there's commerce, education, social functions, tall, dense buildings, the heart of the city, right? And we're going to arrange these buildings in an amphitheater here around this uppermost lake. Now, I just want to say that there's a lot of different ways this could go. And some of you are probably upset because I've created centralized business, governance, and commerce in the uptown. You're thinking, why not decentralize businesses, governments, and commerce in clusters and spread them throughout the city? instead of concentrating them all, with the result of separating out the residential parts of the city and concentrating all the housing in a different zone. And maybe you're right, and that would be my city version 2, but for now, we're just gonna keep it simple because this is really more about water flow and solar aspect than the social aspects of urban land use. Part of putting all of the taller buildings at the top is that they don't block the solar access of any of the residential areas below. So, at the tops of these hills, we have the main municipal water supply tanks to gravity feed the whole city. Here are my water supply tanks. Now, where this water supply comes from is going to depend on the location of regional water sources. But we're not going to go into that level of detail on our model right now. So here, we've got our upper zone, and when we have rain and our upper zone, then that water is going to drain off of all these buildings and road surfaces, and it's going to fill up that upper pond there, okay, and hold that water up above, and below the highest uptown area, we have the residential zones beginning below the key point. Now, this again is set up with streets sloping towards the valleys from the ridges. So I've put in the residential area and the pathways leading to the center here. Each one of these roadways is also a drainage swale, and also it's a vegetated park, which helps to absorb the rain and provides tree-lined avenues for recreation, shade, and wind protection. They collect the rainfall from the buildings and roads and absorb it as it drifts towards the valleys. Now you'll notice that the water flow is in the opposite direction than the typical keyline cultivation pattern that we've been looking at throughout the course, where the drainage slopes from valleys to ridges. The reason for this is the huge amount of runoff during heavy storms. When this system is at high water flow and all of these swales are full and flowing, then the ridge is not a good location to handle all that stormwater overflow. We'd have to construct massive drainage structures to move the overflow down the ridges. But the valley form can handle massive inundation. This whole valley is a forested park which connects these residential swales. The ridge roads are also treed, making a contiguous canopy that connects all throughout the city. Okay, so I've put in trees along a road going up the primary ridge, a road going here on the main ridge, and then another road going down the other primary ridge, these tree-lined roads. Now, the wastewater from all these buildings is piped underground along the same drainage pathways and concentrated in the central valley. So it's going along the roads, it's going along the swales and berms and everything, and all of the wastewater is brought here to the middle. Then at the lower end of Midtown, here and here, is where any heavy industries would be located. So these bigger buildings are our industrial zone. This is so they can have their own pre-treatment of any effluent before it enters into the central system and into Lowtown. They can use biologic treatment systems to clean their wastewater in living machine or eco machine type systems that we talked about at another point during this course. So now we have all of the water concentrated here at the base of Midtown at this point right here. Now this includes all the rainwater directed through the system and all of the wastewater from municipal, residential, and industrial zones. This is the point where we locate any more pre-treatment needed before the water enters the next level of the city forest. The city forest is a vast and verdant forest that processes all of the wastewater and takes all excess runoff from the city. The forest is integrated with parks and recreation, forest products and management, botanical gardens, wildlife sanctuaries, ponds and wetlands, and could have all the best features of the nicest parks in the world. The water is now spread out again from the valleys out to the ridges, through piping and through surface flow. It can even spread out to adjacent watersheds depending on what the topography is like and what there is there. And then beyond the city forest is the water reconstitution zone, where the riverfronts are not developed with towns and industry, but left wild, receiving clean water flowing down from the city through the forest, again, with corridors and continuous tree canopy stretching all the way up the valley bottom, all the way to the hilltop and throughout the steppe city. So there you have it, my version of the city forest. Thanks to PA Yeomans for the inspiration. With water flow as the basis for design, we can really make sense of some things. So, thank you for listening.